conscious time now, and people must come together with identity. And you know what? Yes, everybody and everyone have the answer. Everyone have the answer. You don't fool yourself. Everyone have the answer. Everyone knows what can bring this identity. People don't let them use or not.
I'm in Hollywood with Ester Anderson, documentarian. The film is called Bob Marley, The Making of a Legend. Now, it's about her time with Bob Marley, the early times, and following him as he was, I guess, in his creative process, I could only put it. Ester, tell us, what's the film about?
Well, the film is based on some footage that I shot with a video camera, one of the first Sony ever invented. 37 years ago, really, and I was using this camera to shoot some blueprints from that. We would then create a script to make a film about where the music of Bob Marley and the Wailers of Bob Marley, the Wailers as they were called.
So you were thinking
time.
Very far in advance, because you were shooting footage of him long before people probably knew who he was.
Love, peace, in harmony.
It was the autumn of 72. I just finished a film called A Warm December with Sidney Poitier. When I got a call that I had to be in New York by my agent, when I got over there, everything was postponed for a while. And I went to a party given by a record company, Island Records. And while I was there, I met Bob. He walked in with a friend and introduced him to me. He greeted me in a very sort of alien way. I'd never heard anybody talk like that before. He said, "Hail." He looked very much like Jimi Hendrix at the time. He'd just been signed to the label, and but he didn't really know much about the rock world. And, you know, basically I've helped a lot of the Jamaican artists that we'd brought over from Jamaica, like Millie and Jimmy Cliff before, and that I should sort of keep an eye on him, help him, you know, introduce him to people and so. So by the end of the evening, you know, we started talking, and my friend told him that I was a movie star, and he knew all about me, he said. And I said, "How do you know about me?" He said he had followed my life story in the Jamaican Gleaner.
How much did he collaborate with you in what you were doing, and maybe help you and talk to you about how he wanted to be shot, how he wanted to be portrayed, how he wanted to be seen?
Not at all. No, the thing is that he didn't know, they'd never even seen a camera, much more touched one. If you see in the film, you'll see both Peter and him interacting with the camera. All the stuff that I have, that I could leave in, I have left in for the people to experience this person who has become such a phenomenon. That he was just a kind of fairly innocent, fairly naive, rebellious young man. And Peter, Tosh, and the rest of the Wailers are very similar. They were, to me, they're quite innocent. They hadn't been in the world outside yet.
When I watched the documentary, I did pick that up. And he seemed very, like, innocent. It was an innocent time.
Yeah.
He was speaking from the heart.
Yeah.
He wasn't trying to keep on script or have talking points.
Or being a star.
It was a long time before that. And he was just kind of just natural.
At that time, they start opening up a lot. It was just always Bob and Peter. It was all to do with being repressed as a people, following their old ways, which they were not for. They definitely wanted to break out and be free, really, and be treated as equal and not be second-class citizens in their own country. Talked a lot about also how religion holds down the people, fool them, and churches and the preachers and all of this.
Stand up for your rights. Hey now, stand up. Don't give up the fight. I say, preacher man, don't tell me that your heaven is on the earth. Yeah. I know you don't know what life is really worth. It's not all the glitter is gold. Half the story had never been told. And now you'll see the light. What you gonna do? Stand up for your right.
I don't think he believed from where he was in that time in history that it would be as impactful as it turned out to be.
No, but he always said, he always believed that the music would find its people. He always said that my music will go on and on and on till it finds its people. That's why he kept on about I could never leave him because his music would follow me wherever I go.
It was a transition time in Jamaica for the music also, because yes, prior to that, there was a whole different style of music.
Yes, yes, rock steady.
Right.
We had rocksteady before that. And that's what's great about Jamaican music. It's always progressing. It's always moving. You cannot hold it down. And just because now they've labeled the Jamaican music, period, as reggae. You know, reggae is a new music. We had everything else before. We had ska. Ska brought in a lot of attention to the island. Millie Small had a... Bob Marley did not have a chart record of his own. It's Eric Clapton that took a record into the charts. For
right.
Him.
The I Should Be Sheriff is what he was talking about in your film also. Yes, and a lot of people believed when Eric Clapton sang the song that he wrote it.
That's it. That's it.
This one goes out to those who are going through the rough and tough times, and my mother marvel at you, and I did, and I love you.
Oh,
from the heart.
Hey, yeah. I slept on the city lights on empty streets. See, my mother was a pauper. I was looked down upon in scorn, ridicule, and laughter. Pretty much a child without a father.
How protected in Bob Marley's music is the family today?
Well, I don't think that the family have actually benefited from Bob leaving without leaving a will, because between the lawyers, the ex-owner of the record company, who owns the intellectual property of the entire catalogue of Bob Marley, and apparently the Wailers' early works and his late works, they don't stand a chance. Apparently, we understand recently that that African princess, she owns quite a lot of the publishing of the Marley's catalogue. She, Chris Blackwell, who is the ex-owner of Island Records, and of course Vivendi, Universal, who is in charge of the music. And
on the film, yeah. Bob Marley, The Making of a Legend, what would you say is a thing you want people always to pay attention to in the film that brings out the actual flavor of the movie?
What to bring? Well, I wanted them to actually see Bob as a real person. You know, the myth building and the cult building. First, kill him off, turn him into a cult, then you turn it into a myth.
Let me ask you one. I think there's an obvious question I need to ask, because you said everybody was young back then, yeah. And I saw those photographs of you back then, And Bob back then, and the families and everything, everybody looked very young. Mm. Any dating back and
20s,
forth?
Yeah.
Anything going on?
Mid-twenties.
Do you know what I'm saying?
Were we in a relationship?
Anything.
Well,
In the movie, we talk about that.
We go into details about that. So people, hopefully, they will buy the DVD and they can hear everything.
Okay. All right.
But I couldn't tell you everything because, you know, we have 96 minutes to tell the story.
I know.
So I gave, basically what I really wanted to talk about in the film is the work, really, what we did to concentrate the film on the work, what we were trying to do, and not go straight just into this emotional thing that I exhibit between me and him. Mm-hmm. Because when people work together closely, these things happen.
Something's happened.
But, you know, he wasn't working with Cindy Breakspear when he went out with her, so these things happen too. And men in Jamaica also have their own version about how they live their lives and what they want to tell women and so. My partner from the record company invited me to come to Jamaica and come around the islands to Trinidad to the carnival. And so I didn't see him again. And then one day he came there at Hope Road, which was our office at the time. And he introduced me to Peter and I invited them to come around the islands with us that Chris had invited them. And Peter refused. And then he spoke also in a very strange way that I had never heard before either. He said, "I man no want mix up with no Babylonians." Got to Haiti, however, we were separated from the group. Bob and I were put in a hotel on our own and the others went off on their own. And I just thought it was very strange, very odd that we were, you know, left. While we stayed in the hotel together, he told me everything about his life. He told me about the band, that I'm going to love the boys. Family and Carly, who were the original upsetters. But he also had a dream in the night. He told me next morning that he dreamt that those people had dragged him down into a bottomless pit.
Where do people get the film, online, the DVD or the CD? Where can they go?
Well, the DVD and the CD is in iTunes. Mm-hmm. They can download it, buy it, whatever, view it, or listen to it, whatever it is that young people do. Mm-hmm. The film itself is also on iTunes for viewing, downloading, whatever, and that's much cheaper. Mm-hmm. The DVD, which is your hard copy, will come to you, signed, depends who you buy it from. If you buy it from the website, which is www.bobmarleythemakingofalegend.com, all joined up together, same title, the website is the same title as the film. Mm-hmm. So that you can get that gift wrapped, sent to you direct from the website. So no waiting on it there.
The film is called Bob Marley, The Making of a Legend. Yes. Ester Anderson, thank you for your time.
Thank you so much. And thanks very much for you and your company for giving us the time.